Hi, it's Jessica DeMasa with WTF Health, and I'm here at Frontiers Health. And joining me in the studio right now, I have Donal O'Neill. He is the founder of the POP protocol. So tell me right off the bat, what is this protocol?
Well, I think we need to start at the beginning, Jess, because...
To the very beginning.
I first came to Frontiers in 2016 to talk about a movie that I had co-produced with the brilliant young British cardiologist, Dr. Asim Malhotra. That movie was called The Big Fat Fix. It fortunately did very well. It was very well received. Off the back of that, we published a book initially in the UK last year called The POP Diet. That did very well. A lady called J.K. Rowling kept us out of the number one spot in the UK, but right now we're number two.
Not surprised. Boy wizard or diet.
It's hard to take down those wizards. But right now we've been number one in the Netherlands for 5 weeks. And after I first came here, Roberto Ascione approached me and said, well, why don't we look at digitizing these pillars of longevity and lifestyle that you found down in this village called Piopi? And that's what has ultimately become the Piopi protocol.
Okay, so let's take a couple steps backward and break this down even more. So where is Piopi? Give us a sense of where that is and what are some of these lifestyle principles that have formed the core of your message here?
So Piopi is the UNESCO anointed home of the traditional Mediterranean diet. It's about 2 hours south of Naples in southern Italy. The population is about 197 and has been for, I think, the last 50 years. And it's like a little time capsule.
Okay.
It's a gorgeous little fishing village, which feels like everything life should. And people there have a tendency to live for a very long time. So we wanted to go and investigate why they lived for such a long time. And
is it like disproportionately long compared to like averages for other places?
It's disproportionate in a lot of ways. They live on average at least 10 years longer than people anywhere else in the world. But the men in Piopi traditionally live considerably longer than the women, which is highly...
That's very surprising.
Yeah, it's very surprising.
Okay.
So it's a place that has been protected to a large extent from the ravages of development. By virtue of its geographical position. And everything from the soil to the sea is pristine, and they don't have a word for organic down there. I mean, they grow their own stuff.
It just
is. And they're wonderful people with a wonderful outlook on life. And we think that a large part of why they live so long is that they continue to move and they enjoy a very stress-free existence, as well as the food that they're obviously enjoying.
Okay, so is it those three things? It's the food, it's the stress-free, and it's the movement? Are these the foundation principles behind the POP protocol?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, the stress one is difficult because science doesn't particularly love it because it's tough to measure.
Sure.
But it's certainly very powerful. And after our first 3 days in POP back in 2015, Asim turned to me and he said, you know, there's something really powerful here that you can feel, but it's very hard to understand what it is. And he obviously sees patients who are in highly stressed environments coming to him on a regular basis. And as human beings, we can always tell when someone visually is stressed.
Yeah.
So we know it's damaging, but it's tough to measure, but it's also...
So what did it feel like? I mean, just your anecdotal, you know, description of it, what does it feel like?
Piopi feels like nowhere I've ever been.
That's not very helpful.
I've been to some beautiful places and I've lived in some beautiful places, but it makes you feel very safe, very secure, very peaceful, very relaxed. And it's not a place that's surrounded by dramatic nature. It's on the sea, but it makes you feel almost like you're kind of sleeping in a hammock under the trees on a beautiful summer's evening.
Okay, that's a helpful description. That sounds very good. And is it attributable to, I mean, you said it's not in a particularly beautiful place. So is it an environmental that contributes to that feeling, you think? Or is it the people? What is it, the vibe?
I think it's all of it, and I don't think we'll ever identify every aspect of it. So we've done our best to try and understand how and why these people live so long and so well.
And so what have you deduced here? What have you pulled out?
Well, we've introduced concepts that can be applied wherever you are at any particular time, because we can't all live in Piopi. I mean, they have siestas. You know, they obviously live in a very hilly terrain. So the movement is constant and was constant because traditionally these people would have worked in the fields.
Sure.
And that's something that's been left behind. There's no scheduled exercise. There are no gyms in Piopi. Obviously, with the climate there's an abundance of vitamin D, but that's coming from the sun. So when you add all of that up, plus the very strong social links, you know, the elderly are very much involved in the community down there, and there's a beautiful way amongst the society there that they kind of nurture each other. And that's something that I think we miss in a lot of Western societies. So when you add all of that up, it's difficult to say which parts of that are sure. really doing, you know, X percentage, but they're all doing something for sure.
Is there, I'm curious about how you had mentioned that you and Roberto Ascione had started a conversation about digitizing this. So how do you digitize that? Or just, I mean, because part of me is like, well, wait a minute, if we digitize that, is that defeating the purpose? Or is it helping it grow exponentially by bringing it outward and integrating more people in? So how are you digitizing it, and what has been the impact so far?
Well, I think it's important to understand why we're digitizing it. And Asim Malhotra, the third partner, is an interventional cardiologist in the UK. And one of his favorite quotes is from Dr. Christian Barnard, who was the first man to conduct a heart transplant down in Cape Town. And he said, I've saved 150 lives through heart transplants. Maybe if I'd focused on prevention, I could have saved 150 million. Mm. And that's where Asim comes from.
Sure.
But there's only so much you can do and only so many people you can reach as an interventional cardiologist, let's say. And the one thing that digitization allows us to do is to share these principles with as many people as possible. Whether people choose to implement them or not, of course, that's all down to behavioral economics, amongst other things. But we can only do our best. And you know, the movie was a big hit. The book is now in 10, 11 countries. It's in 6, 7 languages, and it's doing very, very well. So this is a logical next step to scale up the opportunity for a global audience to understand what the principles of PRP are and how to apply them in their own particular environment.
Talk me through the digital experience then. So what does this mean? Is somebody getting like a tip a day, or like what is this digital experience like?
Well, it's pretty unique. I think we've got a couple of secret sauces in there. Oh. I mean, obviously, Asim is a difficult man. You really don't want to meet him on a professional basis. So we're allowing you to meet him on a
That's a lovely thing to say.
Yeah, I mean, who wants to see a cardiologist? There's got to be something wrong with you, right? So he'll pop up along the way, introduce himself, and as you move through what is initially a 21-day protocol,
okay.
he will give you advice. And when you're feeling certain things, we know when that's happening. So he'll pop up and explain what's happening in your body and what to do next. We've also featured the PRP chef himself, Antonio Marinelli. And without Antonio, I wouldn't be here today, and none of this would be happening, because we took a camera crew to Southern Italy in 2015. We didn't speak Italian. Nobody there spoke English. And somehow Antonio found us. He's a magnificent chef. He's got a restaurant in Pioppi called Sussettibile. And it is magnificent. And he became our guide, our friend, now a big participant in the app and the platform. So he's the chef. He will introduce himself. He'll ask you what your priorities are and what style of food and you like to eat. And the platform will respond to that and offer up some solutions. Equally, there are opportunities for movement, and we'll be tracking things like energy levels as you mm-hmm. go through the day. So everything will intuitively respond to the input that you provide to the app, and it's been future-proofed. So as we move to the point in time where, let's say, the Apple Watch has got continuous glucose monitoring, we take that blood sugar reading and we will respond to that through the app with specific recommendations. So it's
cool.
Future-proofed as well.
Okay, so what kind of engagement have you been getting from people with the app? And then I'm curious too, what aspect, is there any data that you can share with us about what aspect people are working on the most? And have you been surprised by that? Are people tackling diet, or is it they're like, oh gosh, I do need to move more? Is there one area that seems to be kind of setting itself apart in terms of an area people are trying to work on?
Sure. Well, the app itself is only now available for, appreciation. It's available at app.prpprotocol.com.
Okay.
So we haven't been using the app out there as a commercial entity just yet. But what we have had are obviously tens of thousands of engagements through the
sure.
book, through the movie. And we recently featured on a Dutch television show. They ran a special on the PRP diet. So they followed 3 people for 28 days on the protocol under Asim's guidance. Then they flew them all down to PRP. And, you know, we had one type 2 diabetic who went into full remission, came off all medication.
Wow.
A lady lost 10 kilos. It's about 22 pounds in the US. And the third person's risk factors for heart disease improved dramatically. So Asim knows as a cardiologist that we can dramatically improve the lipid profile and the blood sugars in a very short period of time before we typically start to see things like major weight loss. 10 kilos in a month is actually quite aggressive. We normally see about 1 to 2 kilos a week max.
Sure.
So we're seeing a fantastic response. I mean, support groups have popped up on Facebook and through social media, not anything to do with us. They've just kind of grown off the popularity of the movie and then the book. So we're getting magnificent feedback. And one of the plans next year is to conduct a clinical trial so that we can understand a little bit better what is really happening in a, let's say, a more scientific environment. It seems very passionate about gathering meaningful data, and that's one of the first things we will do. We're here to raise some money to help us do that, in fact.
No, that's fantastic. And so talk a little bit more about that, because I was going to ask you, you know, especially now it seems in, like, in digital health and in healthcare in general, it's like preventative is having a difficult time getting funding. So, I mean, if and you're kind of embarking on this journey, so how are you guys going to tackle that?
Well, it's a good question, but if you look at companies like Virta over in the US, my good friend Sami Inkinen, Sami actually starred in my second movie called Running Fat. He's a remarkable person. But I love what they've done, and just this week, in fact, they announced a performance-based pricing model. I think they're the first to do so. And it's kind of, you know, we pay based on performance. If your patients come off insulin, then you're going to pay us. If they don't, you're not, which I thought was a brave move.
It is a brave move.
Very brave move. But I think they've been really an early pioneer. And I think there's an understanding that there's profit in prevention. We're seeing very strong signings from the UK government. It seems very close to some of the members of parliament. And the deputy leader of the Labour Party in the UK lost 7 stone on the PRP diet. And he popped up on BBC television and said, we got to change government policy now. The way Brexit is going, he might have an opportunity to do that next
year.
<go. laughs> But, you know,
finally, a positive outcome.
You know, I don't think we've got a firm, fixed opinion on what the commercial model looks like. But,
sure.
You know, we've grown organically to this point, and now we're ready to push out, we're ready to conduct the studies. We'd like to run a full medical conference down in Salerno at the Healthware headquarters, which is linked back, I believe, as far as the 10th century. It was one of the original seats of modern medicine, the building
yes.
that they now occupy, as you know.
Yeah, I did. I had a lovely opportunity to visit over the summer, and it was just fantastic. And yes, the history of medical innovation in that town goes back centuries.
Exactly. So it feels like we're in the right place with the right partner, and now we're ready to put an executive team in place, because Pier Paolo and the guys down in Salerno have done a magnificent job building out the technology. Now it's time to go and meet the world.
Very exciting. Well, we look forward to meeting you there. And hopefully we can all get ourselves at one point or another down to Italy and visit POP in the flesh. That would be great. Thank you so much for joining us. It's a pleasure to speak with you. Good luck with this endeavor. I mean, such a noble cause, really, to spread this message.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you. Pleasure. This is Jessica DeMasso with WTFL here at Frontiers Health. Thanks for joining us.